Okay, so I guess everyone's tweets have gone out into the whole wild world, and your Facebook statuses have been updated. You've posted your Instagrams.
Reply to 10 emails.
Reply to 10 emails. And have taken a sip of tea and coffee and a bite of a sandwich. Okay. Let's start again with a little game then, obviously. We can't do something different than the first session. Okay. So in this game, the buzz groups, I want you to listen to the story I'm going to tell you, and then you're going to just in twos, or let's say in threes, where there's only one person extra, I'm going to pose a question. And the question is going to be, how ethical is the proposal I'm going to put to you? Okay, let's start. Black rhinos are obviously highly endangered animals in South Africa. And as you know, Southern Africa is reeling under poaching, where the rhinos are killed, their horns are taken off, and the carcasses are just left in the fields. And those horns are then illegally exported from the country. The poachers target places like the Kruger National Park and some other nature reserves for this poaching, to such an extent that each year we lose several hundreds of rhinos due to poaching alone, which is clearly a big problem as it is addressed at ministerial level. The nature conservation section in government then decided to come up with a few recommendations, because they received reports from the SA Police Service that indicate that about 90% of the poachers are somehow linked to Vietnamese citizens, to Vietnamese syndicates of some sort, the reason being that rhino horn is regarded as somehow a magical cure in Vietnam, especially for the cure of cancer. And there's quite a bit of a history around that whole idea. Then these officials made the following proposals to try and curb this. They didn't say it, because most of the individuals are either from Vietnamese origin themselves or linked to this. They want at all international airports there to be a separate check-in counter for everyone carrying a Vietnamese passport. Okay, separate check-in counter. At this check-in counter, all Vietnamese citizens must check in for the international flights out of the country. They must report to this counter 4 hours before departure, instead of only 3 hours as for the rest of travelers. The reason being that at this check-in counter, the airport officials and the customs officials must compulsorily search all baggage, hand and check-in baggage, by hand, all of it, as well as there should be always sniffer dogs present, and all scanning apparatus must be made available to scan all luggage to check that rhino horn or little parts of rhino horn is not being taken out of the country in this luggage. Okay, now the question is yours. Would you say this will withstand the principles of ethics? Will these recommendations from the nature conservation officials be regarded as ethical? If you say yes, you must obviously say why you think it's ethical. And if you say no, you must also say why you think it's unethical. Okay, I'll give every buzz group, so 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 3, buzz group 3 minutes to quickly make a decision on this. Is it ethical or unethical, and the reason why? You've got 3 minutes.
It could have been better. 2, 2, 3, 3, 2, 2, 3, 2, 3.
Okay, that's fine.
Two, two.
You face me.
Everyone, regardless of race, gender, whatever, whose end destination is Vietnam.
But from the side of the reminder, think of it this way. 800 rhinos are dying. They are researched. Say, the chances are somebody who comes from something to do with the death of this. The chances are, only 10% of the 9 of the 100 that is happening now. That will mean you will have
all Nigerians should be searched because they will
bring up.
The issue is not all Jewish ones. It's syndicated. So to subject all to this horrific elimination is way of doing
the court has a judgment.
The jury is in.
The jury is in.
30 more seconds.
And get to the root of issues that are affecting South Africa, who are involved in the preaching itself because of issues of poverty, unemployment, and all those things. If you address such issues, you eliminate chances of people being easy targets or working with the system because of money, rather than subject all nationalities of the how would you feel when you arrive saying that you
okay, colleagues? This group has boldly declared they've reached a judgment and ready to rule.
I'm just giving the point of
view. I know.
So while they are so eager, let's give them the first chance to tell us what they think.
No, we think it's totally unethical just to focus on Vietnamese citizens. Who says Rhino horn is being smuggled out by Vietnamese people, firstly? And secondly, Vietnamese people leaving the country are not always flying to Vietnam. They could be flying to New York, they could be flying to Paris. And then why only Vietnamese people? Anyone connecting on a flight to Vietnam should be searched. Who says if the Rhino horn has been smuggled out via directly to Vietnam, could be going out via Mozambique.
Yeah.
And it's just general stuff, focusing or discriminating a person based on a specific race or group. What if a person's mixed race, half Vietnamese, half white, and you're going to search them halfway? It doesn't make sense.
Okay.
Everyone should be treated equally. Everyone going to Vietnam in that case, then everyone should be searched.
Yeah.
And who says rhino horn has been smuggled out just at the airport? It could be being smuggled out at all border posts. So all border posts, everyone leaving should be searched.
Okay. Let's hear some additional views, please.
I think we somehow agree with the first group that it's totally unacceptable and unethical from the point of discriminating against nationality. And instead of getting to address why it's
kind of on happening and so forth, you go at the end in terms of trying to catch them while they leave. Rather, try and address what is causing this to happen in our country that so many rivals are being involved. And if you address that, you somehow eliminate other aspects that leads to that, rather than subjecting discriminating against people because of their nationality.
Okay.
It's unethical based on
Let's have one more group. Any additional views that you would like to add to those? Anyone that says it's ethical? Okay, so the general consensus is it's unethical.
My first reaction was it's ethical, because I think from a nature point of view, because we're in charge of not only people but nature as well, I would say it's getting desperate. People are looking for desperate ways of limiting this. But if we talk about it, then you think that's how long is that going to keep? How long is that? That's a measurement that is one of many ways of getting through customs anyway. But from an ethical, I would say I think it's desperate times.
Okay, so if you have to say which ethical principle is then being violated in your minds in this proposal, what would it be? Well, what is the unethical aspect here? What's the principle that is not upheld? Dignity. And I heard an important word, discrimination, or that the principle is non-discrimination, obviously, which is then that unequal discrimination, there's no legitimacy for it. Yes, I think I have to agree with you. But can you see how easy one can often start off with this argument, that it sounds good because it's going to lower the what happens at the end. But can you see that is that principle where the individual is suffering because of the wider society is somehow going to benefit. and then once you start to reason, think about that, you start to talk about, start to share ideas, then you start to say, no. It can't be like this. There's something more at stake than just lowering the numbers of rhino horn poaching at the end. And you actually start to ask critical questions. Is this going to work in any case? And you can quickly think of scenarios that's going to be bypassed very, very quickly, easily. The poachers are always one ahead, it seems. So they're not going to be deterred by regulations like this. And who's going to suffer? Citizens that are traveling legitimately are going to be targeted, and they're probably not the ones, because the poachers are not going to use this avenue any longer. And so normal citizens from Vietnam traveling out of the country are going to feel violated. If we put ourselves in that situation, I don't know if any of you recently traveled to the U.S., but if you travel to the U.S. from pretty much every African country, you get searched more than others. All your stuff is searched, can you see? And what does it make you feel like? You feel, come on guys, I'm not a criminal here. Please catch the true criminals. It's not me. Can you see that kind of thing? I mean, you feel like that because others are not treated in the same way, and you feel, okay, so why am I being set aside just because I carry a South African passport? Is that valid? Can you see what are we doing when we do this? Actually, a very interesting thing in ethics that we call the reverse or the self-test. To always put yourself in that situation and say, how would this make me feel if I'm on the other end? And often that's a very good test. If you feel uncomfortable being on the other side, then you must know from this side, you should ask and think more about it.
Okay. I just want to find out, at what stage are we going to apply animal ethics? Because what we have just said, it only covers... How can we balance the situation?
Yeah. Of course, we're not going to do the animal ethics in this workshop at all.
No, but for this scenario.
Yeah, for this scenario, I think that's where we need to ask those further questions to say, the problem is real. We're not downplaying the problem here. The problem is poaching. The answer is perhaps not what the recommendations are. that's where the unethics come in. Because we have an obligation to look after our biodiversity. So there is a definite obligation as well. And that is where, if you remember correctly, in that first, or in that slide where I showed us 16 principles, there is also protection of future generations. And that protection of future generations is where we look at biodiversity, for instance, where we look at pharmaceutical research on medicinal plants, because those things affect people that will come in 50 years when none of us are around still, can you see? And so what we do now must make a difference there, or we have a responsibility in a forward sense as well. And so when we look at protection of rhinos, we don't just do it for ourselves. We do it because we realize there is much more value in terms of a longer term perspective here, protection of future generations. And so that is where some of those principles will come in, where we will bring in animal ethics, but wider still, environmental ethics, where we look at global warming, water pollution, all of that. That we are not just only concerned for ourselves. We know if we don't look after the resources now, it's going to be destroyed for the future. And so people will look back and say, we are now in a bigger dilemma because those guys 50 years back were not thinking clearly about what they were doing. And can you see, that's where we ask questions around, let's say, nuclear power. Is it sustainable in 100 years' time? And I'm not saying yes or no here, but those are the questions we should ask. The way that we generate electricity, is that sustainable? Can you see? And so I think all of that links onto your question here, that we must take all of this into consideration. Those are other ethical principles that we're not really going to address now, but we should take those into consideration, definitely. Yes. Okay, so what we are looking at is then human dignity. You obviously have seen that's the next topic. But human dignity, and I was actually, Nina, challenging you earlier when you used the word dignity. So, okay, so what does it refer to? because often we say the word and we have an intuitive understanding, but we find it difficult to put words to it. Human dignity is, in one sense, that we treat individuals as an end, not as a means to an end. This principle was laid down quite a few years back by a German philosopher, Immanuel Kant, and it's been sort of said in many different ways, in many different texts, not just from him, but in many religions. We also look at this kind of principle, but let's think about it. We must treat humans as an end, not as a means to an end. So what does it mean? We must look at individuals as persons in their own right. They are not objects that must serve my purpose, or objects that must serve the purpose of science in general, or must serve the purpose of research. Because what do they then become? Then they become lab rats. They become merely subjects of my research. Can you see? So one must look now carefully. Dignity to treat humans as an end, with human rights and all of those things, not as a means to an end. So we should actually not use humans just for the sake of using them, you see, to serve our own end. And we will unpack this a bit because that's a very important one. This principle of human dignity in some ethics writing and some ethicists around the world actually regards this as the most important principle in bioethics. To say if you uphold this, you will probably uphold many of the other principles. If you don't keep to this principle, you will struggle to meet the other principles, to treat or to respect human dignity. So what does all of this mean? It means the following. Human dignity refers to the equal, inherent, inalienable human worth. Okay, so lots of words there. Let's look at each of them. Equal. Equal means, obviously, like the human rights, every person enjoys or should enjoy the same dignity. So just because a person is male or female shouldn't make them treated less with less dignity. Because they're young or old, different. Because of racial category. Because of qualifications, you see. Because of position. None of those things should actually play a role. We should treat persons with the same dignity, equal. Okay, which is a big challenge, huh? Let's think of, I often go to Steve Biko Academic Hospital because some of my students are working there. And so if I walk into the front, I'm not sure if you've done that before, but if you walk into the main entrance of Steve Biko, that is where outpatients are and where the pharmacy are. And what do you see? Rows upon rows of persons waiting there for hours already at any given time. And you just feel there's something undignified about this. Can you see? So it's a big challenge, but can you see what's the problem here? Limited resources that play a role. But in principle, we want to treat everyone with the same dignity. And can you see that the challenge here is that persons in a position often want to be treated with more dignity. and so we are sometimes often guilty ourselves, so I must say I'm often guilty of that because I have a title. I have a certain standing in the eyes of my students, etc., etc. Let me give you a silly example. The other day I went to the library and it was like a long row of students waiting to be helped. And the librarian saw me and said, "Ah, doctor, let me quickly help you. What must I do? Must I say, okay, let me skip the row? Or must I say, oh, that's fine, I'll wait." What did I do? It was unethical. Because why was I treated with more dignity? Because I have a title. It's the only reason. And the librarian said, "Oh, please come." Yeah, so there's no reason for me to jump the queue. Because I am actually then regarding myself as somehow entitled to be to quicker service than the students. Can you see? Small example, but so easily it can happen because we are, I think, as a group, in a much better position than many other people in society. We work at a university. We have certain post levels who drive certain cars. We know a lot more. We have knowledge. Can you see? And then it becomes very hard to treat everyone with the same dignity. You see, but in principle, we want to look at this. I saw a hand.
Again, it goes back to principle and,
yes.
And practice.
Yes.
Theory and practice.
Yes, exactly.
And the choices that we made.
Yes.
And the example that you gave me there,
yeah,
to say you jumped into the queue. So I'm asking, I'm thinking from my own personal as well, sitting, standing,
yeah,
in the long queue or do that,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
Which,
yeah,
is allowed.
Yes.
To go through,
yes.
I'm not any much more, you know, we're all human.
Yeah. Exactly.
So how many of us can get here?
Yeah.
It would take us to actually,
yes,
not be selfish in a way.
Yes.
Even though we know that what we're doing is wrong,
yeah,
and just continue doing it.
Yeah.
So you see, for me, it's deeper than,
yeah,
than just,
yeah,
knowing that,
yeah,
right,
it's comfortable when you are in the good position, but you will be grumbling if you were standing in the row. Exactly. Can you see that reverse test?
Yeah.
If I was standing in a row, what would I have liked to see happen?
Yeah.
Can you see? So it challenges us, huh?
I'm trying to see the other way. If, and I think the purpose of all this is to get to that position where we are able to realize that if I am the head of state and I get into that queue and I'm asked to come in front,
sure,
and I refuse to go in front, what a difference is going to make.
Yeah.
If I drive to the Steve Biko Hospital, as,
yeah,
you just mentioned, and there are all these women and children,
yeah,
standing there for hours,
mm,
and somebody recognizes me and says, "Oh, Your Excellence." So, no, I wait for my turn.
Yeah.
What an impact, because,
yeah,
there's every chance that the service is going to be speed up and everyone is going to get good service,
yeah,
because of me.
Yeah.
So I think the purpose of what we're doing,
yeah,
here is to get us to a position, all of us,
yeah,
to a position where we can make the opposite decision,
yeah,
because we know,
yeah,
is going to change the life of everybody,
yeah,
just there.
Exactly.
You just mentioned something about resources. I don't think it's about resources.
Mm.
I really do not think,
mm,
it's about resources. I have seen been in a couple of situations,
mm,
where it's not about resources at all. In fact, with little resources, you get the right attitude.
Yeah.
People with the right attitude.
Yeah.
they're going to make a huge impact.
I fully agree with you.
So
yes.
maybe one of the outcomes, if we could ever get there, where from a workshop like this, our mindset changes a bit.
Yeah.
That when we are called to come, oh, Dr. Chanyi, can you just come to the front, please? No, thank you very much. I appreciate it. But please, I would like to respect my position in the queue.
Yeah. Thank you for that.
When we watched the first video, I think the one thing that came through, and it's coming through again now, is the word selfishness. I think every decision we make, even if we fight for human rights, we're still selfish about about because what are we going to get from that?
Yeah, exactly.
That element of selfish, when we had our one-on-one again, remember we spoke about greed and selfishness, and we discussed briefly what creates that. I mean, if some of us have raised children and are raising children, and we're instilling what type of values in them, because perhaps we're born with that element instinctively to become greedy or to become selfish. But now, if you have such a, if you're raising a child, what type of values are you instilling for them to know that, you know what, we can share, we can do this, we can what do we do as a society, as a people, as human beings, to you know, try and address such, you know, tendencies of that are inherent to become selfish?
Still
think there's a room for us.
Of course, I think it's a big room, definitely. There's lots of need for it. Okay, so human dignity is equal. It's also inherent. It means that thing, you have dignity. You can't lose it because you are a human being. You can't not be a human being, can you see? So we mustn't think position or money or anything gives us dignity. Sometimes we do that. I mean, even the dress I'm wearing, sometimes always it's sort of a social thing that people will say, okay, he's neatly dressed, he's got a tie on, whatever, he hasn't got slacks on. I mean, it shouldn't actually matter. It shouldn't matter, can you see? But so we are sort of in a system where often dignity of some sort is afforded to persons with, that can speak the loudest, have the highest income, highest position, all of that, can you see? And people that don't have it are somehow treated with less dignity, which is very important. I think it's especially the ones on the lower end that we must look at. Think of how we treat our students. Do we treat the bright students and the poor students the same? Or are we somehow leaning towards the bright students because they contribute to class, I like them, da da da. Can you see? It challenges us in many ways. It's also inalienable. Means you can't lose it. Can't lose it. There's nothing you can do to take away dignity from somebody. They should be afforded. We should recognize it. Nothing in persons can make them lose their dignity. Not lack of money, not lack of IQ or low IQ, anything. We should take that as a measure of, okay, you can get less dignity. Think of older people. We are living in a society where there's lots more people getting much older. But what do we do with the elderly? We put them in elderly homes, forget about them, you see. Somebody I know is working in a prison, psychologist. And so what I'm always impressed about her is that she has a real heart for those prisoners because she doesn't want just to leave them there. She has all kinds of programs to teach them skills, to help them understand what is happening, even ethics training. Can you believe it? It sounds amazing. To make sure that when they go out, they can actually contribute to society again. Because it's something against society if that same person ends up in jail again a year from now. And you see, then society has somehow failed this person. I mean, it's not just society's responsibility, that person has a responsibility too. But can you see those amazing things that we do? We look at those individuals that are often regarded as somebody with less dignity than what we think they should have. And can you see dignity, that human worth, is regardless. The human worth is inherent. It's not linked to a specific characteristic. I think we must, it's the same as with human rights. The dignity is because it's a human, not because of anything else. If we put any other measure on it, we are making a big error here. and we are on dangerous grounds, can you see? Because next time, just down the corner, we will be in that position, and then we will not be so happy, can you see? So we can look at all of those. But now, what does human dignity then bring to this discussion? Human dignity, I think, can result in an increased respect for diversity. Think of it, that's one of these challenges, that often persons are scared of diversity, scared of persons that look different than I, believe different than I, vote different than I, and somehow, let me just not associate with them, which is actually a bit strange. If I'm comfortable with giving every person the same dignity, I will not be scared about diversity. I will actually embrace it. Because in a sense, in the UNESCO system, the other day I saw a nice thing that says, diversity is an asset of humanity. we don't want to see homogeneity. We want to see diversity. And why? Because diversity brings different perspectives. How valuable is that?
If everyone was the same, would we be a boring place?
It would have been a real boring place, yes. So we want to see diversity, but can you see the respect for diversity means I need to have respect for human dignity. Otherwise, diversity is going to be a big problem for me. And so we must always think about it. And I think we're often challenged by this when we travel to countries where there are only a few people that look like I and believe like I do. I remember last year I traveled to Turkey, for instance, which is largely Islamic. And so then you are challenged. Suddenly there are different sounds, different foods, different dress. And then you must say, okay, am I still going to do my thing here? I mean, it's easy where you feel comfortable. It's much harder when you're put in a different situation with different diversity. And then that challenges your ethical thinking about stuff. Okay, so it increases respect for diversity. But I also think it's going to increase our respect for privacy. We're going to look at privacy a little bit later on. And autonomy. Remember, autonomy, where every person can make their own decision. So if I have respect for dignity, I will allow you to make your own decisions, even if I don't like them. Can you see? It's not only the ones I like. I will respect your decisions, because you're an autonomous being. So that is what human dignity brings. On the flip side, it will reduce things like discrimination. Because what is discrimination? It's where I put people in little groups because I want to distance myself from them. Can you see? And I can stigmatize them. Think of a big problem that is rearing its head now and again, xenophobia. It's deeply seated in this, where we find that diversity a threat for many reasons. And so what do? We stigmatize those foreigners. Can you see? The word is already stigmatization. Those foreigners. They're not us, them. Can you see that us, them? That is actually going against the whole idea of human dignity, can you see? So we can easily end up discriminating against individuals based on characteristics that we don't like, and worse, stigmatizing those individuals that justify that I can treat them as less human, because that's what happens with stigmatization. The moment I see somebody as those persons, then somehow I feel legitimized to hurt them, to speak ill of them, to give them less services, can you see? And it's because of this human dignity.
It ties back again, bring it home, xenophobia,
yeah.
The Kuro issue that is,
yeah,
in the media right now,
yeah,
using language,
yeah,
to discriminate.
Yeah.
You spoke about irrespective of when you started, ethics irrespective of your cultural,
yeah,
background and so,
yeah,
so some,
yeah,
still needs to learn about human dignity,
yeah,
and ethics.
Of course, yeah.
You can't use language,
yeah,
to continue discriminating and,
yeah,
stigmatizing people.
Yeah.
So even in this country, we still have a long,
oh,
way,
yeah,
based on,
yeah,
the number of challenges that are facing,
yeah,
us. So,
yeah,
for me, it's more of conscientizing and continue,
yeah,
because,
yeah,
like we said, it's a continuous,
yeah,
effort that we try,
yeah,
to do to make sure that,
yeah,
people's dignities are upheld.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, it's,
yeah,
all over the news.
Yeah.
Taking each other to court,
yeah,
just to remain stigmatizing and,
yeah,
discriminating against,
yeah,
each other,
yeah,
which is,
yeah,
against,
yeah, yeah.
You know, what we strive yeah. for.
And can you see, I think that just highlights the fact that it's often regarded human dignity as one of the central concepts in ethics. Mm. That if we miss this, then we're going to struggle with any other ethical arguments even and behavior. But if we start with this, then we have at least a good foundation to work on, because you will see all the other principles, all of these are actually based on that. That human rights, human dignity, actually you can put there in all of this, you will see how it's going to be just different ways, different ideas of giving true reflection to this. So we're going to link back all the time these concepts to those. That's why we start with this. Although it doesn't sound as if it's got much to do with research, you will later on see how this is the central concept, that it's going to link back to all these research concepts that we are so well familiar with. Okay, so let's look at a little bit of a movie. I hope you can understand Italian. Okay, you can. I see you not, so let's go ahead. This movie or this video clip was made by Italian students, and they speak Italian, and I'm sure you're going to be able to follow it. Okay. It's going to be a short clip. What I want you to do is, while you're watching this clip, think about what we've said now about human dignity and how it plays out in this movie. Now, Nina's perhaps going to be in an advantage here because of her inclination towards the arts. She's going to see some stuff that we might miss. But maybe some of you have got some hidden talents here, because there's more than just the words at play in this movie. So have a good look at it. It's a real nice way that I work with the concept in this movie. Okay.
No, io sono diversa.
Io sono diverso.
Io sono diverso.
Io sono diverso.
Io sono diversa.
Anche io sono diversa.
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 Io sono diverso.
Anch'io sono diverso.
Io sono diverso.
Io sono diverso.
Okay, so let's hear it. What do you think is the message I want you to get from this?
Everyone, in the beginning, everyone is treated the same, and it's a conformity, same
yeah.
repetitive.
Yeah.
Everyone's the same, and yeah. you don't go deep into it. Everyone's different at the end of the day. Everyone's yeah. different, everyone has unique characteristics that everyone should take into account.
Okay. Okay. Something more?
Maybe being different is good.
Different is good, yes. Why is it good?
If everybody, like somebody said earlier on, if everybody's the same,
yeah,
it's going to be very, very boring.
Yeah. 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 Something else perhaps that you saw in the video clip?
I think most of them, they were not able to make their own decisions. It
yes.
was like there was a common pattern of doing things.
Yes.
Until one of them recognized that there is something completely
yeah.
different. And then everybody
yeah.
was being different.
Yeah.
Acknowledging that they are different. They don't keep on doing the same
yeah.
thing. All of us.
Yeah. Yeah. What blocked that recognition of diversity in the beginning? What was the block? Why wasn't it possible in the beginning? In terms of the movie, remember with the masks? All the masks are the same.
Mm-hmm.
And so what does it mean? Every person standing in a row has the same face. And so the real face is hidden behind. And so can you think of situations where we treat people as if they've got masks on?
I'm just thinking of students. We see all students by a number.
Yeah.
All students are just a number, a student number.
Yeah.
But they're individual people.
Yeah.
They're all different.
Yeah. And so we treat them all the same because they, in a sense, we see them as having masks. Can you see? And did you notice in the beginning of the video clip the color of the clip?
Mm.
It was just all gray, boring. Mm. And then they played with that color when they took off the masks and that little kaleidoscope. Then it became a colorful movie with nice music, obviously, playing in it.
The flip side to that for me would be classifying those differences depending on the people in the position
yeah.
of power
yeah.
and the ideology
yeah.
at the particular context and time frame
yeah.
to say because you this
yeah.
therefore you're going to be treated in this way and this way
yeah.
and not embrace and
yeah.
tap into
yeah.
what diversity can bring
yeah.
rather than use that
yeah.
so it's twofold
yeah.
you can abuse or abuse
yeah.
what diversity stands for
yeah.
before you even give me a chance
mm.
you've already judged me based on what your preconceived are
yeah.
based on the diversity so we
yeah.
need to be
yeah.
cognizant of the fact that this can also be abused and how do we address that
yeah.
yes the
yeah.
movie shows that
yeah.
Being different is good, but yet being different again can be
yeah.
a tool that others are using
yeah.
to put people in
of course.
Area.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Yeah. So
yeah.
Another flip side.
Yeah. So I think what we must do is we must sometimes always look at language, because language often shows what we are thinking.
Mm-hmm.
And so listen to the language that we use. We speak about students. We speak about engineers. We all of them, and when we say the word, we think about something. Can you see? If I use the word Nigerian, what are you thinking?
Mm.
Drugs. That's probably what we all were thinking right at the beginning. So can you see how we use words, those masks, we put masks on persons. And it does serve a purpose. Remember, categorization per se is not wrong. I mean, we need to sometimes say male, female, for whatever good reason. Old, young, first year, second year, third year, can you see? But there, it's a legitimate category. We must often even challenge that, the legitimacy of those. But so the categorization is a wrong per se, but it's how we handle that.
Mm-hmm.
We can handle it in a positive way, or we can handle it to somehow treat people less, with less dignity, and then it's unethical, then it becomes a problem. Okay, so the movie actually wants to say something of that. To treat or to see the diversity is hard work. Think of it. To learn everyone's name is much harder than just say, oh, you guys. That's easy. That doesn't take much energy. But it's harder work for me to try and remember everyone's names. And I know I struggle with it. But that's one of the challenges. Can you see? Just small little things. And I think we can think of many stories. I remember one story of a teacher that was teaching in a foreign country for a year or two, and she came back to where she lived, and then two or three years later she went back to that country, and she met one of the children in her class, And the guy just was like excelling. And she asked him, so what happened? And he told her, the first day you taught us in school, you remembered my name. And that motivated me to excel because somebody saw me for who I was. Just that one little, I mean, you don't even think of it. But that's the power it sometimes has, to not treat everyone with a little mask on, because it's easy to do, but to see that diversity and embrace the positiveness of it. Okay, so what's the principle here? The ethics principle is this, that the interests and the welfare of the individual should have priority over the interests of science and society. So what is it trying to say? It says this, that we must see individuals for who they are, and that should have priority over the interests of society or science. For instance, how do we speak about our research participants? Often we just put them in the same group. They are so-called subjects. I personally hate that word, and I never use it. Because what does subjects mean? You are subjected to me as a researcher. Can you see how I put a mask on those participants? I don't see them for who they are. And so we must be careful. The individual is more important than science and society here. Or if we say it in another word, the bottom one, if we bring it back to what Immanuel Kant has said, science, the research that we do, is not the end. Think of it, why do we do research? We do research to serve society. If science becomes the end, what happens? Because when science is the end, that is when we just do research to get a doctorate, when we want to publish, because it's my CV that's going to get longer and longer. Or I'm going to go to Hawaii for the next conference, and it's really nice for me. But can you then see what happens? If science becomes the end, the participants become the means to the end. And the participant become the means to the end of science. What should actually happen? Science should be the means to serve humans. That's the right way around. And can you see how it's a small little thing, but it's a huge thing actually in terms of ethics, how we treat humans. If we realize that science is the means and humans are the end, we will know that science or research is just a process to serve humans. It doesn't matter what we do. In all your fields, you are all serving humanity in different ways, or supposed to serve humanity at least. You don't just do it for selfish purposes. It's not just another career, and you do it for the sake of science, because science for the sake of itself is empty. Can you see it becomes a selfish pursuit, and should be the other way around. And can you see how that links now with human dignity? Human dignity goes down the ground when science becomes the end. And human dignity goes up when science becomes the means to the end. The research becomes the means to the end. And how easily does this happen? Think of how often we become really anxious when we don't get enough participants. And so we then frantically run around to get participants. But can you see, then somehow the science starts to be the end here. We had a nice discussion earlier in tea time about this, that participants can voluntarily choose to not return a questionnaire. And I shouldn't force them or put them on a guilt trip or anything like that, because they are the end. If they don't want to participate, that's fine. I, as a researcher, must come up with some creative ways to get enough data to do proper stats. That's fine. But not at the cost of humans, not at the cost of the ethical principles. And our students get easily caught up in this, or staff members. From time to time, I get phone calls, and it goes like this. We want to go to a conference next week. Can you give us ethics clearance? And then what's my short answer? No, but I usually don't say that. I rather say, I don't think that's going to be possible. You should have asked for ethics clearance like 1 year back, not 1 week before your conference. Because can you see what they are trying to do? The conference is the end. The ethics is just sort of along the way. It's just another thing to tick down. Mm. And because the conference wanted to see an ethics letter, now suddenly the ethics principles is important, but not when they were doing the research. So my sympathy is not very, very big in those cases, unfortunately or fortunately perhaps. I just say, well, sorry for you, you're not going to get an ethics letter from this committee, which is defining the purpose. Small little things, but we see it often happening, or when students sort of start running out of time, and then they start to easily engage in unethical practices. And can you see, all of those factors are very real. It's not, I'm not downplaying those factors, but so easily we can become caught up in our little system where the science and the research become an end in itself, and participants start to suffer in the process because my focus is starting to go the wrong way. And it's easy, because what do? We live in a society where it's publish or perish. That's the reality. If every year you have to submit a promotion report to your HOD or to your director to show what you have done. And so we live in a society where performance is important, and it's I fully go with that. But it shouldn't be at the price of unethical behavior, and that is how we caught up. Little things like corruption doesn't start with 10 million rand bribes. It starts with $10 bribes, with little chalky bribes, can you see? And it builds, and you get caught up in a system. So we must be aware, and that's why it's so important. I sort of so like what you're saying with curriculum development, that the ethical principles must be embedded right from the start. I mean, we work on tertiary level, but we actually want to see that right in grade RR. It must start where we can, as educators, have an influence. But we can't. We work with first years, and we must do what we can, full well knowing it should have been done a long time ago, and hopefully with parents and the community where people live in. One of my colleagues, the other day, was we were speaking about children skipping school, and he said, listen, where I grew up, you wouldn't have thought about doing this, because if any adult saw you in the little town during school time, they would have given you a hiding just there. Because the community were looking after, it's not your parents, the community would have given you a hiding. And so what values were instilled in him? To be diligent, attending school, etc., etc., because the community cared. There was a certain value system running there. Okay, so let's look at a definition here, sort of in terms of ethics jargon. And the words that we look at is the word duty or obligation, because we've used it previously to say we've got an obligation. So what on earth does that mean? Means the following. An obligation is a responsibility to adhere to values in a specific context or to follow certain rules of conduct. So a duty or obligation is to say, if you believe in this principle, you will do the following. So it's not just I take the principle. If I take the principle of equality, then I shouldn't skip the row. I have an obligation or a duty to wait my turn as everyone else. So in philosophy terms, that is what duty obligation will be. So let's look at what obligations does human dignity put on us. So if we truly take human dignity as a principle, what should we do? And we can do two things, or there's two big things. The first one is that we have a responsibility or a duty not to harm other individuals, because they have dignity. Can you see they have value? So I'm not going to harm or injure other individuals just for the sake of it. So I have a duty to avoid harm. And you can see the sort of the word that we often use here is the word non-maleficence. Non-maleficence means not to injure, not to inflict harm. So we have a duty to make sure that in our research endeavors, others are not harmed, are not injured in a way. And that's difficult in itself, and we will come back to that. But also, it has an obligation to do good, to do good. Okay, and so let's look at that. to do good is where the word beneficence come into play. Just on Monday we had an ethics committee meeting, and there was a project that was going to do research on certain companies' cleaning staff, and they were going to measure heart rate, blood pressure, blood sugar levels, etc. Okay, which is obviously good. But then one of the members said, okay, is this student going to give that information back to the cleaners? And if they see some heart conditions, are they going to refer them to a physician? Are they going to give them health advice on how to perhaps eat better to avoid, let's say, diabetes, etc.? And all of those questions are actually on this, the duty to do good, beneficence. If somebody participates in research, how are they going to benefit? Is there something good going to come back to them? And we have a duty, can you see, because I believe in the human dignity of those individuals. So I must want to do good for them in my research. I shouldn't just use them as sources of information, sources of data. Then they're just lab rats, can you see? So two sort of opposite obligations, not opposite, but two that's on the opposite end of a continuum. We have a duty to avoid harm, non-maleficence, and a duty to do good, beneficence. Okay. So let's see what is happening here. There we go. Okay. So if we must summarize those two obligations, we can put it perhaps something like this. That human dignity is a minimum threshold of respect and care. You see, it links up where we started, to say human dignity is one of the essential bioethics principles, if not the most essential one. Or in other words, it is the minimum threshold. So it's not maximum, that's the least we must do, is to respect human dignity and to respect them in terms of how we treat individuals. And that includes research, obviously. It includes many other things too. How we treat each other is also based on human dignity. But then especially where we are heading towards research, it is how we treat participants must be based on that minimum threshold of a respect for human dignity. Okay, so let's look at the case study. Let me tell you a story about this. And what I want you to ask yourself is, how can this specific person, we're going to call her Susan, how can we treat Susan with dignity? Okay, so that's an easy question, but you will hear the story is obviously a bit more complex than that. Okay, Susan is a 50-year-old female. She is a devoted teacher working at a secondary high school where she teaches biology, and she's really in love with the subject. Her students like her a lot, the children in her class. And she's really passionate about biology, how it can change the world around health and all of those issues. She's also very much involved in community work. She often on Saturdays will go out into the community, contribute, do some stuff, be involved in soup kitchens in winter, etc., etc. So she has a heart for her community. She also has a family and is happily married. Then her family started to notice that she repeats questions that she's just asked 5 minutes ago, that she forgets where she put her keys. And so you obviously realize that within a few months' time, she can't remember much. We see that she can't even recognize close family any longer. And so obviously she had to stop working. She doesn't know which school she works for or that she even have to go to school. And so she was very quickly diagnosed as suffering from Alzheimer's disease, suppression of her memory capabilities. Okay. The university close to her home has a film school, and the postgraduate students at this film school is doing a number of projects. One of the projects is that they are making documentary short films about mental health disorders. And so one of the topics is that they want to make a film about Alzheimer's disease, how it influences cognitive development or the degeneration of cognitive capabilities. And they want to do these films obviously for postgraduate studies, but also ultimately to make it available to the university psychology department, that psychology students can then actually see what different psychiatric or mental health disorders look like, and they can be, it can be used as teaching material. So the one student that is aiming at making a film about Alzheimer's disease then approaches the ethics committee to ask for permission to do this project. He then proposes to include Susan in his study, and there are many reasons for it. He feels that he is aware that her family has a number of video clips when she was still fully functioning, and so that would be available. And he would then propose that he want to make some additional footage of her current situation, and perhaps also to see a little bit of further degeneration in her condition. Okay, so he then comes to the ethics committee to say, will you guys give me permission to conduct my project and make this documentary film? Remember now the question, you are now on the ethics committee. And the question is, how can Susan be treated with dignity in this project, if at all? And obviously the second question is, would you be in favor of the project, or would you say that there are some unethical issues here which the student can't work around, that it's impossible for him to treat Susan with dignity while portraying her in a film in a undignified situation? Because obviously Susan will not even be aware that she's filmed or being able to give proper consent to be filmed. What would you say?
I think your last line kind of gave it away. Because if she was in the early stages of Alzheimer's and you approached her and you got voluntary participation and she was willing to participate to say, okay, you are allowed to film me over the next few years, I think that would have been a different situation. But now she's in the case where she possibly doesn't know what's going on around her. Yeah. I think there are some ethical issues.
Okay.
At the end of the day, the video is being made available for the psychology department, which is beneficial, but you are kind of using her as a tool to get there.
Okay. So the psychology students will just have to go without these forms, not see anybody that's suffering from Alzheimer's or perhaps schizophrenia, because all of those conditions are inherently undignified for those persons. So must we then just turn down his application?
I also think that perhaps the way in which he films, if he's not intruding on her, and perhaps if her family is supportive of this taking place, if her family gives the go-ahead and gives approval, I think, and the family can monitor that the research is not infringing on her rights and in her face the whole time.
I think that. Okay, there's a possibility. Any other suggestions?
Sorry, I also feel it depends on the person. Because she's not capable of making decisions, so somebody has to make decisions for her in general life. And it's the person closest to you.
Mm.
I think if she was a community member and she was very avid about promoting health or whatever the case may be, and her husband or whoever's making the decision would know that she would want to do this, then he could maybe give permission. But if she was a very private person and he knows that she's a very dignified person and would not like her to be seen out in public without makeup on, for instance, and now she's in a state where she isn't like that anymore, he would then have to say sorry, no. So I do think it's also up to the person who mm-hmm. is being filmed.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Other ideas?
I tend to agree with her to a certain extent because there's a general good here. And given the scenario you've painted, this person was doing a lot of work in this. I'm thinking, yeah, you look at the family, but sometimes I watched a little movie or something like that. I'm trying to recollect mm-hmm. where this person actually surprised everyone when she was approached.
Mm-hmm.
She actually stood up and talked about herself, and she was actually challenging the crowd and saying, I know you look at me this way. And I mm-hmm. so sometimes it's, I just simply want to say, it's not going to give up before mm-hmm. you even try it.
Mm-hmm.
And start the processes where she's talking about, in case this person totally cannot. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes people surprise us.
Mm-hmm.
When we have given up, and then you approach this person and realize that they are not as bad
mm-hmm.
as yeah. we thought. So maybe mm-hmm. approach this person, but if that fails totally,
yeah.
then maybe someone who really understands this person,
yeah.
who is able to reap what they stood for while
yeah.
they were still very functional.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there could be a way.
Yeah. Yeah. And would you then say that will restore some of her dignity? That she will be treated with dignity in such a situation?
To some extent, yes. Mm. If these are my values and what I stood for, I would say yes, this is a legacy.
Yeah.
It's just how you approach it.
Yeah.
If this is one of the core values of this person, whatever,
yeah.
okay, doing this as a last thing, if that person were to die the next day, would be the best thing
yeah.
they would have wished
yeah.
to do
yeah.
in this life.
Yeah.
So it depends on the approach and what this person stood for.
Yeah.
And if somebody is able to understand this and articulate it in the right manner without without having their own selfish
yeah.
ends, you know, maybe I just want my family to be known, things like that, which can become a problem.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, you're looking at it from the person under study's point of view. Perhaps by denying her this opportunity, you are infringing on her dignity.
Mm. Yeah. I think you guys are really getting to some of the ideas. Can you see how important it is to see the individual? Because if we look at it from what I've given you in the scenario versus a person's very private, we would have made two completely different decisions here. Because in that situation, putting that person in a video would be absolutely horrifying if she knew about it.
Mm.
While in this situation, putting her in the video would be something that she would have chosen for herself probably.
Yeah.
Can you see? And so that's actually what happened here. The committee invited her husband to the meeting and asked him, what do you think she would have wanted? And he said, she has always given her life for education. She has always loved medical science. She has always been involved in community service, and she would have definitely opted to contribute to the last second by not giving this as something that is flashed before the world, but in an education setting. Remember, psychology students are being trained to better understand patients in future. So it's going to contribute, and that's exactly what happened. And they then actually did give permission for this film to be made with those conditions. It's not used as a commercial film at all for the sheer value of sensation or anything, because that would have been unethical, can you see? Yeah, so it's all about human dignity at the end. Even though she couldn't give consent herself and there are processes, her husband could say this is what she would have wanted, probably would have wanted. And they went with that. Okay. Let's play a game. This game is going to work like this. Oh, sorry.
For the game, I just want to get some advice from you. This is the situation that existed within a public hospital, whereby this another old man was suffering from a heart disease.
Yeah.
So that man used to go to the hospital for treatment. But every time he goes to the hospital for treatment, they used to admit him for some few days and then they release him.
Yeah.
But there was a situation whereby this old man used to complain about the cardiological clinic, that the doctor, every time he observed him, he would normally call the students
to
come and see the visiting patient every time.
Yeah.
And the old man complained to the manager of the hospital, not the manager, but someone at the lower level, like a nurse, and say, I'm not happy about it. Every time I come here, the doctor calls the student doctors from next door. There's a university next door that come and see. There's the only they do observation, they take notes, they do blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
But surprisingly enough, the response from the nurse was that, remember, old man, this is an academic hospital. So the doctor got the power to call his student to come and do the observation as well while he's busy observing you at the same time. But my question is that I think here there's something that has been tempered or that has been attacked towards the particular man, such as human dignity and human rights and all of those things. So my question is that how does this hospital allow, if the patient is unhappy or is uncomfortable about what they are doing, what is your take on that particular part, especially in terms of ethics and
I think if we just think about this, what has happened there? Social utility trumped individual rights. The social utility in terms of education, etc., they just said this weighs heavier than this person's individual rights, which I disagree with. I think what should have happened is that the physician could have asked his permission. Can I invite a few students? You have a very unique heart condition that we can learn from, and I would like a few students to come and observe and ask you questions. And then the person can say yes or no, and that the hospital should go with that, but not force their will on that particular patient. So I would definitely have gone with that, to say to treat the person with dignity, give him free choice. I mean, that's what that self-responsibility is. Do you want to be exposed? Because if we think about it, what is the main function of a hospital? It is to treat a patient's illness or disease. So who should benefit? The patient. That's why I go to hospital, to get better, to get diagnosed, etc., etc. Anything else is secondary to that. If it's an academic hospital, that's fine. But I didn't go to the hospital to become part of academia. I went there to get treatment, remember. That is the understanding of going to a hospital. And so that is the situation that should take preference. Being exposed to students doesn't contribute to my treatment. It actually doesn't bring anything, but it can do me some harm. I can feel embarrassed. I can feel exploited. So think of the obligation. Obligation of human dignity, the second one, or the first one, a duty to avoid harm, non-maleficence. And I inflict harm if I embarrass you when you are here for a legitimate reason that you can expect to be properly treated. And so I will never go with that. To just say you don't have a choice here, it's an academic hospital, is just saying social utility trumps individual rights. And if we truly subscribe to human rights, one shouldn't go with that at all. So I would definitely I would say that's unethical from my perspective.
And from the academic hospital side of view, I think if the first option of not having the students there, there should be other things in place that can still get all the information needed from that without harming the patient by having student doctors there. So that information can still be used in another manner afterwards. So the purpose of academic hospital, nobody is going to be negative against that or not be able
shouldn't
to use the research because it's still available, just in another way.
Yeah, exactly. And in all of those, the individual rights would be upheld. You would value those, and that's what should be done. But can you see, it's easy to just say, no, it's an academic hospital. It's an easy argument. And can you see how that also, in a sense, exploits sometimes a person's unawareness of human rights or the unawareness of what is happening or what should happen here. So by I'm the nurse, no, your argument, I throw it out as if it's nothing. And I actually violate your human rights in that too. So yeah, that's a very interesting question that you've asked. And I think it happens more than we think, or something similar, can you see? That's why, let's say for instance in our situation, in classrooms, why are students in class to receive teaching and learning? If I do anything else, I must get their permission. If I want to distribute questionnaires for my little education research, they didn't come to class to be research participants. They came to class to be learners. They've actually paid for it. So can you see, so often we see, and I mean often, TUT staff members are increasingly using their own students as research participants, which is not in itself wrong, but then they can't understand why they need to go through ethics and get permissions. And they need to understand, okay, but why is the person here in the first place? If I do anything else, if I doesn't even be research anything else, if I allow somebody to come in and tell them about whatever promotion, that is taking away teaching time. And I must be accountable for that too, can you see? And so the same principle applies in this case. Okay, so let's get to the moral continuum game. How this game is going to work is that you're going to get up again, just to get the blood flowing a little bit. And there's a U-shape here that starts and it goes like this, all the way around. Okay. So this side is where you say you fully agree with what I'm going to say. And you agree a little bit less, you're in the middle, and then you disagree absolutely with what I say. Okay. And you can stand anywhere on this U-shape. Okay, anywhere. And I'm obviously going to ask you why you stand where you're standing. Okay. The scenario is this. If we do research on street vendors, okay, there's lots of them around. If I do research on street vendors and I want to interview a street vendor about their business practices, management sciences, business practices, I have an obligation to compensate that street vendor for loss of income for the time they are being interviewed. They could have done business, but they were speaking to me. I was asking them questions for half an hour. And so I should calculate how much money they lost in that half an hour, and I should fully compensate them for loss of income. You fully agree? Neutral? Disagree. Okay, you must get up now. Make your choices. Fully agree, neutral, fully disagree. Shouldn't give them anything, in other words. If you participate in research, you do that free of charge. And you know, you are completely outside of. Okay, so let's ask you, why are you here? You say we shouldn't compensate them for loss of income. It's you participate in research, that's what comes with it.
Yeah, I think at the beginning they must be aware before they can participate. I think those are the first things that need to be outlined as and when you approach the participant to say, by you participating, they must be informed first, to say by you participating in this particular research, it means you're going to be paid or not. So I think they need to agree from the onset. It must not be something that which you just impose on them. But okay. If everything has been clearly stated from the beginning, I think it will be, okay. They will just participate at their own risk.
Okay. You guys are right sort of in the middle. So you are... Okay, so it's your why.
I think it's up to the researcher. You can either compensate them or not. It's up to you okay. to decide. If you do want to compensate, then you've got to work out how much, and you've got to tell them up front how much they will be compensated.
Okay, so it's not up to them to say, I've lost so much, give me X amount. You will
say, I've lost 1,000 rand.
Yes. Okay. Okay.
I think also it depends on the methodology that you're trying to use, what's the outcome of that actual research that you want to do.
Okay.
If you're going to use something like convenient sampling, you want to generalize your studies,
yeah,
then you'll simply get every student that's willing to participate in the study for free.
Okay.
But if you're going to be specifically targeting specific people, they're not going to give up their time for free.
Okay.
Then your methodology is going to change, and then I think you're going to stand and compensate them.
Okay, let's hear. You feel that they should be compensated for loss of income. Why?
You want to start? I fully agree that they must be compensated. Why? Because of we should not take them for granted that they are operating a business that is not formal. And secondly, in terms of the business practices, that doesn't mean if there is no customer, the people are not doing business. A simple person who operates a tuck shop or who owns a tuck shop in a township, maybe by making a phone call or sending a WhatsApp to a supplier, a baker, whoever, is also doing something that benefits his or her business at the same time. In terms of the compensation, I cannot talk about the rates, but I think maybe from the research side, there can be some standard fee that can be used for compensation.
Yeah.
But to calculate it, it might be difficult.
Yeah.
You know, but that's why I'm talking about the standard fee that can be utilized there. You know.
Okay. Okay. Does anyone want to change their position, or are you happy to stick to where you are? Are you going to move a bit? Okay, okay, okay. Let's have a second scenario.
From a moral point of view, as a researcher, you also have, you know, obligations that you have.
Yes.
This is a vendor that is doing business.
Yeah.
You're looking at contributing towards good based on your findings and so forth.
Yeah.
But you need to take the mark on care with
this
gentleman, that we need to take that into consideration when we do our budgetary purposes and so forth. To say this participant, as much as they would do this voluntarily, they are in business, they're doing business.
Yeah.
We need to look at somehow compensating them for
that.
We shouldn't say either you agree or not. From a moral point of view, me as a as a researcher, I need to take such into consideration when I do such.
Yeah.
I'm thinking I'll remain here to say work it in your project plan.
Yeah.
Say I'm gonna collect in this particular sector, this sample. They doing the street vendors, I need to look at how I can compensate them for participating.
Okay, Cisco.
I'm standing on this side because I say that my research, they are going to benefit from my research. So that is what I'm putting back there.
Yes.
Instead of money.
Yes.
It's knowledge that they can use.
Yes.
And if you bring money into the whole thing, I think it compromises some of the
responses. Yeah, I think all of the points raised are very valid. We're going to come to incentives, whether we can pay people at all, or if yes, how much. So we're going to look at incentives. We must realize that all of your positions are fine. Often research requires a sense of altruism in participants. You participate because you want to contribute. I'm not going to give you anything, but out of a sense of being part of bigger society, you might want to contribute free of charge, give your time, can you see? And that's fine. I mean, people can choose that. Altruism is good. But we also realize that this position is just as valid. Street vendors are often living right on the line. If they can't do business for an hour in a day, they won't have enough money this evening to feed a family. That's the reality. And so can you see how that becomes an ethical dilemma? If I ask this person to be interviewed for an hour and they can't do business, I'm taking away the means to support a family. And so that puts an obligation on me as a researcher as well to recognize that. If I want to interview any one of you for an hour and you're not in class, probably, I mean, you're going to get your full salary. You are not going to do less work, I hope. And the university is not going to be detrimentally affected. And I can interview for 2 hours. And it's fine, can you see, without compensation. And actually, if you require compensation, I can say that comes down to a bribe. Can you see? That would be unethical. You see, there I would just say altruism. It's take it or leave it. If you don't want to go with this, then you just choose not to be part of the research. As easy as that, voluntary participation. Okay. Second scenario. We're going to play two more scenarios. Second scenario. You are a sociology researcher that is working on behavior around the death of a family member. So what happens around that particular moment when a family member dies, often in hospital? So you have a project going on the death experiences of family members when a HIV positive family member dies. So you have contacted a family where is a very, very ill person suffering from AIDS. The person is in hospital. You will know this person is going to die within a day or so. You've spoken to the family about your research. They are happy to allow you to be present and to videotape their interactions. They've agreed to it. Remember, the family has agreed to it. To interact, to videotape the interactions, and for you to observe what happens. Just remember, you are interested in behavior of family members at the moment of death. And this particular project is focusing on HIV/AIDS. If you are in the ethics committee, would you be willing to give permission for this project to go ahead? Or would you say this project is somehow still unethical in violating the family's dignity? So you say, yes, you will support this researcher's application to be present. You're a little bit unsure, or you feel strongly that you will not support that application at all, as you feel it's inherently unethical for research to be done in that situation. Okay, so we see a total reshuffling here. And there seems to be a...
Same place.
Okay, so let's start. You guys say that you feel that you would still support such an application. Why?
Because from the scenario, the family has been contacted and they say that it's okay by them. So there's clearance in this regard.
Okay.
And I'm also thinking that the key, the participants here, it's not the dead person. Because that person is dead. It's the people who are still alive, and they say they're happy with it. So I don't see that problem.
Okay. Okay. You're against such an application?
Okay, I wouldn't go through with that because of the stigma around the HIV. And also, I think, because of the stigma, that's my main reason.
Okay, okay, so HIV/AIDS has a lot of stigma attached to it.
Yes.
And you feel that patient or the family can somehow be detrimentally affected if this research is published.
Yes, and then why can't we do the same study for other diseases, somebody who died of diabetic or any other?
Sure. Yeah, sure. That's possible. This researcher focuses on this.
Perhaps the person is specifically researching the stigma aspect.
That's possible. Okay, let's hear. There's a lot taking sort of middle ground here.
I thought it was this side. Because of the space.
Okay, so there's the middle. So let's hear the middle view here.
I think from my point,
I'm very close to you.
As part of the research committee, you know, reviewing this application, I look at a number of things in terms of how the family members are protected.
Yes.
How is this research going to be used?
Yes.
Because you mentioned the good and how it can help. So that has to be explicit to me in terms of how does the applicant, you know, state they're going to protect their anonymity, how the research is going to be used and all that. And based on that, after interrogating that, and looking at whether there's harm or not, I'll weigh and say yeah or no.
Okay.
That's why I'm
okay, sure.
I might go based off if certain things are not clearly outlined, but if they are, then I'll say let's go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Let me ask you this. Would you say, except for you guys that are happy to approve it, let's say from here onwards, Can we do anything to make this research more ethical? That will sway you if they change something in the way they do the research, that you will say, now you would be happy. Because think of it. Mm-hmm. I guess this research is worth doing. Mm-hmm. It's not frivolous research. It can yield very important information around bereavement. There's lots of people dying from AIDS. So it's not willy-nilly research. And so we don't want to just say no, unless we feel really there's no way. This is unethical inherently. What would you suggest to this researcher to make the research more ethical that will sway you to support the application?
The videoing of the whole situation, if that is kept private for the researcher,
yeah,
and his observation, and that information,
yeah,
is then put into the thesis,
yeah,
then I think I would say,
yeah,
one can go,
yeah,
for it. But then there should be a control mechanism, what is going to happen with that,
yeah,
video,
yeah,
afterwards, because,
yeah,
that needs to be kept,
yeah,
private then,
yeah,
forever. Because,
yeah,
I think if I would consent to something if I, mm, knew that would never come out again, because,
yeah,
you don't know how you're going to react. You don't know how,
yes,
what is your,
yes,
your whole situation.
Yes.
You consent to it in principle, but then I think that visual information,
yes,
should be,
yeah,
destroyed,
yeah,
or be destroyed after a certain,
yeah,
period of time, or kept private,
yeah,
or whatever.
So there's lots of privacy, anonymity, confidentiality issues that we will get to. Yes. Please.
I'm thinking from where she's, the angle that she came into this, I want to think that one of the major strides, in my opinion, against the stigma is actually people talking about it.
Mm.
I think the primary cause of the stigma is this idea of trying to hide,
mm,
reality.
Mm.
I think it will help if people know that HIV is there. It's happening. It's killing people, and then we
mm,
break that cycle of,
yeah,
compromising our,
yeah,
position because of,
yeah,
by opening up. I think it's going to actually solve the problem,
yes,
rather than accentuate it.
Yeah. Yeah, so thank you for that view. Perhaps the last question on this one. Would you say the presence of the researcher in the room is problematic? Can this research be done without the researcher being present, actually? Can the data be recorded without the researcher,
yeah,
being present?
Yeah.
Yes.
There's something in tourism,
yeah,
called commodification, where people tend to act rather than do the real thing.
Mm. Yeah.
If we have to stage a show on how funerals are conducted in my village, it would be more of a show than the actual thing.
Mm.
So,
yeah,
the presence of the researcher could,
yeah,
actually compromise
yeah,
the authenticity.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and as you know, that's called the Hawthorne effect.
Yeah.
Hawthorne effect, very important in research. And it has bearing on ethics. So can you see in this regard, perhaps an ethics committee should suggest that they must be totally convinced of the privacy would be respected, anonymity, confidentiality, but then also on the data collection. So can you see sometimes the method becomes an ethical issue as well? That we say, okay, can we do this in a better way? Because we know that people will be affected when there's somebody, because think of yourself if you are the family member and there's somebody sitting on a chair in the corner. It just feels a bit artificial, huh? And so what one can do is to put little cameras on, very unobtrusive cameras that can record, because you're not going to ask them questions, you're going to do observations, remember. And that can be done without you being present. And can you see how you contribute more and more and more to make the situation as natural as possible for this family, that they can properly grieve, because that's a very intense emotion. And that proper research can be done at the same time.
And the person is already dead.
Well, in the process of dying.
It's in the process.
It's in the
process. I'm trying to also,
yeah,
put myself in that position.
Yeah.
Would I want a stranger to be,
exactly,
watching me,
yes,
die?
Exactly.
Rather than my family. So
yeah, exactly that.
That
I fully agree with you.
You.
Yeah.
When you think about these,
yeah,
things, of, you,
yeah,
have to think of
yourself, yeah,
at the other side.
Of course, yeah.
I must think of himself on the other side to say, if he was the one that was lying there,
yes.
And then a stranger comes in and wants to see him die. Yeah.
No, exactly. I mean, you're so right, Kenshi. You put yourselves in the shoes of that person, and you just get a feel for what it would feel like. And can you see where things like credibility of the researcher, that we will never allow a master's degree student to do a project like this, because the person is inexperienced, and there's no redo this. Can you see? So the ethics committee will even look at the track record of the researcher. Is this researcher known for this type of research? Or is it just somebody with a passing interest and can make a decision on that?
It taps into the question that I wanted to check with you, Franz. As the ethics committee, where do we draw the line when it comes to, we spoke about issues of methodology. A person would come doing a PhD or so, and they've got their supervisor, and they have advised them to take this approach in terms of their methodology and so forth. As the ethics committee, where do we draw the line in terms of say, change this, you can change this, you can change this.
Yeah.
How far do we go?
The line is, for me, actually pretty clear. And the line is that the ethics committee should only comment on methodology if the methodology is somehow an ethical issue. If I can say, let's say, put little cameras in, you're not going to be in a room, because that's going to make a very big difference here in terms of the ethics, then the ethics committee will say that. Say, we're not going to approve it unless you do this.
So
take it or leave it.
You need to make recommendations.
Yes. But if I just feel, okay, I rather want you to do personal interviews than focus groups because I personally like individual interviews, that's not a good enough reason. There must always be, and the ethics committee always takes this stance, that whatever we comment on, we indicate which ethical principle applies. And if you can't do that, then you don't, I mean, you want to make a comment on methodology, but it's not up to you. The student supervisor have chosen methodology for a certain reason, and if they've chosen a bit of an inferior approach, but it's not going to affect the ethics, they have to be, they have to answer to examiners on it and explain why they've chosen it or not. And sometimes it's just this or this, it's the same thing, it's going to yield the same type of data, it's just a matter of which methodology I prefer. It's not going to have any bearing on ethics, and then one shouldn't comment, you must refrain from it because you're not the supervisor.
That's why I'm asking that question.
Yeah.
Often than not, you'd find we get carried out and start marking.
Oh, we do. No, we shouldn't.
Rather than looking at ethical issues.
I mean, I see it in my own ethics committee, since I would be able to tell you that we are very strict on it because there's lots of very experienced researchers there. So everyone has to be inside. They feel like, okay, if I'm the supervisor, I would have loved the student to do this. No, you are not the supervisor, you are now the ethics committee member. Stick to the ethics. And so one can comment if there's if the ethics is a clear threat to some other principle.
So the same counts for badly written, bad grammar, spelling mistakes, all of that?
Let's think of it. The time when the ethics committee will comment on it is when the information leaflet and the consent form is poorly written.
Yes.
Because that means I'm going to give participants something that doesn't provide them with proper information.
Okay.
And remember, the information leaflet can be written in poor language, so that will already make me negative towards the research I'm going to participate, because if you can't properly write a document, why should I be part of your research? Which is a valid argument. But I can also write my document so perfectly that only other doctors would be able to understand what I'm meaning. I'm using all the right jargon, but the poor participant doesn't have a degree in whatever field. And the document is perfect, but it's completely ununderstandable for this person. So can you see there's no informed consent because the person cannot judge the content. They are just overwhelmed by very big words, but they don't fully understand what they sign up for. And remember, the principle is self-responsibility. Human rights and human dignity says every person is responsible, and the research participants too. If they sign on the line, what do they say? I'm happy to go with whatever you do. And if they didn't understand and they come back later, and I've seen that last year in the Cape High Court, a participant took a researcher to court and said, I've suffered some kind of injury because of being part of your research. And the researcher went to court and said, there is the information leaflet where I've actually given and explained all the risks possible that can happen in my research. There's the signature of this person. He was fully aware that there was some risk involved here. Something could go wrong. And the court actually went with the researcher in this case and dismissed the participant. He said, sir, but you did sign up. There's the information. You took responsibility for signing up by agreeing to participate. You are now responsible for your choice. We have sympathy for you, for the injuries you've suffered, but you were aware of the possibility of injury in this case, because research has some risk many times.
It goes back to what you explained, the language.
Yes.
In terms of how the leaflet, is the consent form is written. It might be above the person that you are.
Yes.
And they might not have understood what the risks are. So the onus is up to you as the researcher as well to explicit and explain or put it in simpler ways so that the participant knows what they're getting themselves into.
Yeah.
Because if the language is an issue now, it's a barrier. I'm signing into something that I'm not fully
exactly
aware of.
Yeah, and so ethics committees very often make a comment to say, please simplify your information leaflet. It's written too complex for the target participants you have in mind.
The banks would not like that.
of course, but they are forced more and more to write it in understandable language. Okay, let's, you can go back to this. Last comment.
From my side, I think before we start this research, basic committee and the researcher and the family, so we must have the meeting or something like that. And the letter, the patient and the family exactly understand what is the research purpose and what is the process of the research and what is the output we should have. And also we let the patient and the family know what we will publish, what we will just do the experiment and like that.
Yeah.
Because for the patient and other people, they don't know what is research.
Yes.
You just said that you are, I'm a researcher, so it's fine, but at last you use that data, maybe they are not happy.
Yeah.
So we must exactly explain that the patient and the family understand.
Absolutely. I think, and we're going to come to consent a little bit later on, we will return to that. But also this thing that often we think that everyone knows what research is. And if we go into communities which are not close to universities, they might have a very low level of understanding of what research means. We see this often in hospitals where patients think researchers testing some or other medicine is for their benefit. And can you see that's a complete error? Because that's an experimental drug. It can actually not work at all. It can make you sicker. But participants don't realize because they want to have a cure, can you see? And because they don't understand what the aim for research is, they don't understand that they're actually just part of an experimental setup to test whether something works. And the same goes with our students. I mean, I've seen some projects where lecturers want to test a new teaching approach, which is obviously great, but it doesn't mean it's going to work. So we often ask the lecturer, okay, you can implement this new approach, but if it doesn't work, what are you going to do here? Because if more students fail, then something's wrong with your approach here. Can you see? Because they expect to get good teaching. They don't expect to be experimented on in terms of teaching practice. Can you see the difficulties we come into play? And there are ways to work around this. And we suggest that to lecturers. But the dangers. We often think the research is going to work out perfectly. We're going to find this new cure. The teaching method is going to work perfectly. But sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it's worse. Because that's what research is. We don't know. Remember, research is finding out what we don't know. And so we must make sure that we always ensure that participants fully realize what they are involving themselves in. We know, but we must make sure they fully understand. And so I fully agree with you. Okay.